Please listen carefully.
Hello, universe. Welcome to the Optimist Daily Update. I'm Ariel Tienko.
And I'm Summers McKay.
And we are part of the team behind the Optimist Daily, making solutions the news. We bring you reader-funded solutions news every day in order to change the tenor of news media, social media, and the direction of your day to help us all get focused on what's going right in the world.
7 days a week, we publish positive news stories written by award-winning journalists and delivered online to your inbox and through our social channels. And also, we are sharing these solutions in a commute-worthy, walk-worthy, home office-worthy, bribe your toddler with an ice cream bar and put her in front of cartoons-worthy podcast. Today is Tuesday, the 11th of January, 2022. And that is, in fact, exactly what we are doing at this moment. We kept Brennan home from school today because she had a little bit of a fever yesterday. And with everything that's happening with Omicron, it just seemed the right thing to do. She tested negative for COVID, but who knows these days. So I have a toddler watching cartoons and actually watching Ariel and I record this podcast while also watching cartoons and eating ice cream. So big day around here. How are you?
I am doing well. You know, I really admire you for being able to run this business the way you do and also take care of your kid, which is pretty much a 24/7 job. Because I felt pretty proud of myself for taking my dog for two walks today instead of just one. But up against your daily living, it's kind of like a small feat.
Yeah, it's funny because I have, you know, we record with these headphones and these mics, and Kristy and Ariel both figured out that they could get like a gamer's headphone so then they could be a little more portable. But I have this big old fashioned mic and these noise canceling headphones, and I'm like tilting one back to see if I can hear her. Like, are we okay? So I think being a mom and, you know, running a business is certainly challenging. Being a mom is just challenging. Being a parent is challenging. But the realization I came to, and Kristy and I have worked a lot on this, not try to hide the fact that I'm also a mom, not try to hide the fact that we're parents, to not seek out that invisible motherhood that often existed in careers and in professional experiences. And that's why so many women tap out of professional direction and leadership, is because they have to play this role that they're not also a completely harried mother who, you know, was excited she got a bra on. they have to be the powerful executive who knows what the financial numbers are and can understand other information. So, you know, just being unabashedly a mom CEO is sort of my jam. And I'm deeply grateful that the team helps me do it. But with that in mind, this could go south at any moment. So Ariel, let's just get right to the stories. And if we have time, we'll chit chat after.
Well, today my headline reads, floating communities can help us rise to the challenge of climate change. And the reason I picked this one is because it's actually centered around the Netherlands and also a neighborhood that my partner and I used to live next to. So we didn't live in this floating community, but we lived right next to it. And so we were able to peer into those nice houses, open windows that are really popular in Dutch culture that just kind of let us into their world a little bit. With that
in mind. Do people just like not walk around naked all the time in Dutch culture?
I mean, I guess they don't. Actually, fun fact about the Netherlands, they have a lot of bigger windows on the bottom floors to be able to show off their living, their interiors, their beautiful ceilings and everything. But the windows get smaller and smaller as you go up to make it look like the building is even bigger than it is. But in any case, we're not talking about those buildings. We are talking about floating homes, floating houses, as a way to combat increasingly dangerous weather patterns. So for instance, there's a lot of worsening floods. So while some parts of the world are dealing with raging fires, there's other parts of the world that are thinking, what if we sink into the sea? What if the sea engulfs us? So investing in floating communities is just one of the ingenious ways that the Dutch are coping with rising sea levels and floods. And their success has inspired other flood-prone nations like the ones in French Polynesia and in the Maldives to imitate what they're doing there in the Netherlands. So we've written once before about this floating community, which is called Schoonskip. Schoonskip? I'm still working on my Dutch pronunciation.
How's the Dutch going?
It's going pretty good. It's a complicated language, but every sentence is like a puzzle to me. So, but yeah, anyway, this floating community is a safer shelter for residents because they float up and down with rising and lowering sea levels. Mm-hmm. They're more flexible in that way. And because they're floating, they're not going to be completely destroyed by a flood or a sudden storm.
Right. They won't have disastrous, you know, complete community destruction.
Exactly. They're not going to sink because they rise above it. And floating neighborhoods don't just offer safe shelter for the residents, but their presence along the coastlines can also offer communities defense against the floods. And as another pro, they don't require land, which can be a potential solution to housing shortages. And that's something that the densely populated country of the Netherlands is really struggling with right now. So yeah, the popularity of floating homes are on the rise, and officials here in the Netherlands are also beginning to update zoning laws so that the construction of floating homes is more accessible to more people. So you might be wondering how the floating homes are constructed. Well, first of all, they shouldn't be confused with houseboats, which aren't stationary but can be easily unmoored and they can sail off to another location. Instead, floating homes are fixed to the shore by steel poles, and then these homes are usually connected to the local sewer system and the power grid, and they resemble homes that are constructed on land. The only thing is that they don't have a basement, but rather a big concrete hull that acts as a counterweight and allows them to remain stable in the water. So in the Netherlands, these floating homes are normally three-story townhomes, and they've been prefabricated with conventional materials like timber, steel, and glass. But luckily, according to Cohen Althaus, he's the founder of Water Studio, which is a Dutch architectural firm that focuses exclusively on floating buildings. He says that floating homes are pretty low-tech, which gives them a huge advantage as a potential solution for growing climate change concerns. His designs are stabilized by poles that are dug about 65 meters into the ground, and they're equipped with shock-absorbent materials. So if you're prone to seasickness, you're not really going to feel it so much.
Have you been in one of these buildings? Like, I know you've walked by them. Have you actually been inside one of them?
No.
This may be your new challenge. So you just have to go knock on a random's door and just be like, hi, I'm a random writer and I have a podcast that I'm part of.
I would just
and we talked
love
about
to
you.
See your house. Yeah.
And stand in your house and just feel if it feels floaty.
Well, actually, that's one of the things. So these houses also still have unique challenges, let's say. If you are on the third floor, then some residents have said that you do feel the waves a little bit more.
Because of physics, largely, is why the higher up you would feel.
Yeah. And also, these buildings will require more infrastructure. As I said, they're connected to like local sewage systems and stuff. So it's a little bit more complicated to connect them. But even with these unique challenges, these houses have the potential to save countless lives and also billions of dollars in damage. So when deadly floods hit, just like in Germany and in Belgium last summer, it wouldn't be such a catastrophic event. Oh, do you have to go?
Well, everybody, we're just going to pause for a second because there's a little one who I guess needs some attention. I'll be right back.
Brennan's going to be a famous podcaster with all this exposure to podcasting
exactly.
Early on.
So we have a team meeting in about 15 minutes and you are going to have to remind me to change my shirt because it's now covered in ice cream bar. Are you wiping it down for me?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, that's pretty much it for my story.
I think this is a great story. I love all sort of housing and tech design, and I'm constantly looking at architecture and how it evolves, whether it's how we live safer in, you know, aging communities or safer in evolving climates. So I think this is a great story. I am going to talk about cheetahs today. Brennan, does that seem exciting?
No.
Okay. Well, anyway, to the rest of the world, this might be exciting. My headline reads, cheetahs to be reintroduced to India after more than 70 years. Now, the population of cheetahs in India once numbered in the tens of thousands, but following the animal's extensive capture, this beautiful, graceful feline. Oh, do you want to hear? Okay. The graceful feline eventually became extinct in 1952. 70 years later. The world's fastest land animal is now expected to make a comeback in the South Asian country. Brennan, are cheetahs slow or cheetahs fast? Yeah, they're fast. Now, government officials have recently announced a concerted action to bring back cheetahs into the country. As part of the plan, 50 of the big cats will be reintroduced over the next 5 years in cohorts of 10 to 12 young cheetahs at several surveyed sites. The cubs will be imported from Namibia and South Africa as founder stock during the first year. All right. Well, long story short, cheetahs are coming back to India. It's going to be great. They're going to make sure they're not inbred, and good things are happening. Ariel, what else is good on the Optimist Daily today?
All right. So other headlines that we have on the Optimist Daily, how we recognize one voice in a noisy crowd. Tennessee beauticians are now trained to identify victims of domestic abuse. There's a study about how scientists have successfully distinguished zoo animals from their airborne DNA. And European cities could see a lot less cars on the road in the near future. Anything else, Summers?
Pakistan appoints Justice Aisha Malik as the first female Supreme Court judge. This biosensor can detect infections post-surgery. Simple movement is connected to better brain health in older adults. I wonder what simple movement does for toddlers. And chemicals from thyme and oregano can carry anti-tumor properties. That and much, much more, as always, is available on the Optimist Daily. Thank you all for listening to the Optimist Daily Update. We promise to continue to deliver positive, solutions-based news and stories about how you can participate in this changing world and ensure it is changed for the good. Everybody, you know what Ariel's going to ask you next. Ariel, what do we want them to do?
Please consider becoming an emissary on the OptimistDaily.com. For just $5 a month, you can support reader-funded independent journalism. Be part of the solution-changing consciousness and address our world's biggest challenges with a problem-solving mindset. Let's keep the Optimist Daily free to all who need it, supported by those who can. Thanks for listening, everyone. We'll be back tomorrow with more solutions.